Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Come to order, and I'll ask Mr. Lasher if he'll give us an invocation.
Sure. Let us pray. Gracious, praising you
and lifting your name up above all names. We ask for your guidance in everything we conduct at this meeting tonight. We just ask that you give us strength and wisdom in everything we do. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
At this time, I will do the public comments. Peter Childers, and I do remind you, you have 3 minutes.
Yes, Madam Chair.
Okay.
I'd just like to say that following the last commissioner's meeting, in a conversation I had with Craig Honeycutt, I was made aware that public hearings do not have a time limit for public comment. And I think if I was informed of this at the time of the public comment period, when I was cut off from completing my presentation, I think that would have diffused much of the frustration level that I expressed. So I'm aware of that now, and a little happier with that. Mr. Boswell, yes, I was allowed public comment, quite generous, at subcommittee and planning board meetings on the high impact polluting industries. Mm-hmm. But the planning board does not represent my views in front of this body. I'd just like to let you know that. And Commissioner Sutton, at the last meeting, you commented that the new high impact polluting industries ordinance was taken before the public, as you put it, with Jason Martin's presentation to the Commercial Real Estate Brokers Association. My view is that taking it before a private meeting of an industry trade group is not really public. Holding true public presentations at different locations and at convenient times throughout the county would have given all stakeholders a better chance to comment and offer input. And good news, I guess, for the commissioners, I'm unable to attend the public hearing on the high impact polluting industries ordinance, but I've given Beverly Kerr some of my points to make, so hopefully she'll be able to communicate them satisfactorily with everyone. I do think the planning board has put commissioners in a tough position because of its lack of work on proposed industry spacing. Put extra workload on you, I guess, unless you're just going to rubber stamp the new ordinance, of course. But I think commissioners need to understand the implications of these changes and just get them right. There's no need to rush approval of this new ordinance until you understand the impact of what these changes will mean. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have any commissioners' comments?
Yes, I'd like to respond to your comment about something that I said. The best of my memory, I didn't mention the organization that was brought before because I didn't know about it, number one. Number two, what I did make reference to was that I trusted that the committee that I had faith in, because I knew them and knew their backgrounds and so forth, I made a reference generically that I trusted that they had put it through every governmental sift that they could so that the outcome would be fair and equitable, the best that it could be, that I knew it was going to be controversial. That's almost verbatim what I said. So as far as this trade organization, I don't know what you're referring to.
Well, I'll clarify that. I was the one that said that Jason had come to the Commercial Realtors Association and made a presentation.
That's Tom. I'm Tim.
Okay. We have no more public comments, so I'll close the public comment session at this time. And also the commissioner's responses, unless I have any more. And at this time, I will open the public hearing for the economic development incentives. And Mac, if you want to come forward, then does anybody have any questions or you want
to? Thank you, commissioners. I appreciate the opportunity to be here tonight. With me are some folks representing different parties that have been part of this development of the possibility for Ferraro Foods establishing a facility in Alamance County. And I want to introduce some other folks that are here, and then including an executive with Ferraro Foods. And I'll ask them to stand just so that you guys can see who they are. First, Margie Bukowski, who was a representative with the State of North Carolina Department of Commerce, to whom this project was assigned when the state received it. We have Kevin Chapman, an attorney with Parker Poe, who acted as a consultant for the company. And then the person I'd like to introduce to explain the project, talk about the company, answer the questions you might have is Dean Barcelona, an executive with Ferraro Foods. And Dean, if you'll come on up.
This is Alamance County Commissioners. We're delighted to have you here. And if you want to discuss the company and the project, the floor is yours, and welcome.
Thank you.
All right.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Good evening.
It's a pleasure to be here in Alamance County. My name is Dean Barcelona. I'm the Vice President and General Manager of Ferraro Foods. We're a New Jersey-based food distributor. Our mainstay, our industry, is selling to Italian restaurants, pizzerias, and other types of food concepts today. The company was incorporated in 1975, and we've done a lot of growing during that period. We have a presence in the state of North Carolina since 2002 and a facility in High Point. Currently, the facility is kind of small and is stunting our growth, and our efficiencies aren't where they should be, and we're exploring the opportunity to relocate to Alamance County. We've identified a corporate park in Mebane that's run by the Samet Corporation, and we're exploring a piece of property there to see if it suits our needs. And so far, as was alluded by Mr. Mac Williams, we have engaged Parker Poe to help us with some consulting to make certain that we have everything in order to make the right decision. Currently in New Jersey, we employ over 250 people. We employ just about 58 employees here in the state of North Carolina currently. And we have a cross-section of employees that's very appealing to any community. We have clerical workers, administrative workers. We have a sales force, a marketing department, a purchasing department. We have an inventory control area. We have warehousemen, selectors, truck drivers, tractor trailer, straight truck, small under non-CDL type units. They're refrigerated. We have a frozen and refrigerated component to our operation. We don't make anything. We're not a manufacturer. We run a clean operation. We're very proud of what we've done with the company over the past several years, several decades. And we're very excited to explore the opportunities here in Alamance County. We're also very appreciative of the grants and assistance that might be available to us to help us with this investment. Building from the ground up is a very, very significant investment for any company. We're not a stranger to it. However, we've done this in our current location and corporate location in Piscataway, New Jersey. Just a quick historical guideline, we moved from a town called Greenbrook in 1987 to a town called Edison in 1990 to a town called South Plainfield, and now we went into Piscataway in 2001. It's a 115,000 square foot facility with 20,000 square foot of office. We anticipate to put about a 65,000 square foot facility in North Carolina. Currently, our facility is just about 30,000 square feet, and the ceiling height is not very high. The new facility will have high ceilings, so we can stack our racking and inventory control systems a little higher. So that's pretty much the historical background of Ferraro in the nutshell.
Sounds good to me.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
We're glad you're here.
Yeah. Thank you.
Anybody got any questions?
How'd you pick High Point?
High Point was, we liked the location in terms of logistics. We had a lot of business when we first moved out into North Carolina in the Greensboro area, and High Point seemed to be a pretty good spot. We're a very conservative company, and our growth has been very deliberate through the years, so we kind of picked a property that we didn't purchase. It's a rental, and kind of keep our costs down and try to manage our business as prudently as possible, especially in a new area. Back in 2002, we were distributing a handful of accounts in North Carolina, actually from our New Jersey facilities. As we began to grow that business, we decided to have a presence in the state, and we rented the facility where we're at now. Our mindset as a company is to really own the property and control the property, and now we're at that crossroads where we're making that decision to make the capital investment in the real estate and in the operation to stay for real.
So you still have your place in High Point as well?
We're gonna be phasing that location
that out.
Out.
To here.
Okay. Yeah, it's not quite as it's not as efficient as of an operation we envision for a new facility.
Okay.
With that move, are you gonna bring employees from High Point to here, or what are your transition
thoughts? We have every intention to bring employees over from High Point. The commute is not a terribly oppressive commute. It's a very manageable commute, anywhere between 30-35 miles. We have a good, solid employee base there, as well as New Jersey. We're proud of the people we have working for us, hard workers, and we have every intention to bring 100% of the staff complement over to Mebane.
And how many jobs are you thinking you're going to create here, though?
We've earmarked an additional 23 positions in the company. There are some divisions of the company in North Carolina that don't have a presence currently now in the company. For instance, we don't have a purchasing department. We don't have a very large inventory control department. And we certainly anticipate expanding our sales force to have a greater presence and increase sales growth within the state.
Can you share the types of customers? You said the Italian foods, like pizza parlors? Or?
Sure. Our mainstay, our foundation from the moment we started our company has been the mom-and-pop independently run pizzerias and Italian restaurants. That's our core business. That's where our culture is. That's where our ethics are. That's where our values are. We never lose sight of that. So that foundation is the foundation upon which we've grown our company. Since then, we've expanded into national chain accounts, not only Italian concepts, but we also expanded the concepts into other types of food concepts. We do Asian concepts today. We do snack concepts today, yogurt, frozen softies types of concepts. We're also a very respectable redistributor. We try to purchase the product as cost-effectively as possible, which enables us oftentimes to resell that product to other distributors in the industry. And we're a very large importer. We import quite a bit of product from overseas, especially Italy, canned tomato products, olive oils, vinegars, peppers, mushrooms, and such. Making anybody hungry here tonight?
Yeah, actually. Yeah.
Go to your local pizzeria.
Any more questions? Any questions from the audience? This is a public hearing.
Excuse me, Madam Chair. Are we going to be able to speak on this?
Yeah, that's what she
was
saying.
Yeah, this
well,
is
I would like some.
Okay.
I would like to say something.
Well, you can ask him any questions.
Well, I don't really have questions. Well, I guess I do, but it's a general question. I have just a page here that I'd like to talk about, if I could, to make so I can make some sense of it myself.
Okay.
I don't know
how is
you
this
it.
About yeah. about his economic development?
Correct. It is.
Okay.
Oh yeah. Oh, specifically, yes. Absolutely. Okay. So. Anyway, I'd first like to welcome Ferraro Foods to Alamance County. And this county will support your business and your growth, and I wish you much success. As you mentioned, your company is not a manufacturer, but we could use more manufacturing, but it is a clean operation, so that's a plus for us. I did some research, as much as I could, I guess, on a private corporation that you've been established in 1975. And looking at your growth since then, I'd say that you have a profitable company. You've been quite successful. And I'm sure that you did all the necessary business analysis before coming here tonight as to why Alamance County is a good place to locate, such as access to markets, suppliers, good transportation, competitive wages, and low taxes. And I'm also sure that you're aware that this state and this county have taken tremendous economic hits over the past 2 to 3 years, with probably more hits to come. And the state has had to fire many workers, and this county has forced its employees to take unpaid furlough days and curtail department budgets and to help balance their books without raising taxes. But many taxpayers are struggling. I'm also sure that your company staff has taken part in discussions about how governments are spending too much and need to cut taxpayer programs and subsidies to people who don't need them. So I'm wondering then why you need $62,250 from our county. We appreciate the jobs and the investment, and as I guess it's somewhat of High Point's loss, but you are going to transfer jobs. But you'll get that investment back in the course of doing business here, and without this subsidy, and while still being profitable. So I'm looking at your investment here of $6.2 million. And the $62,250 that you're requesting is about 1% of that. And I just can't believe that a 1% subsidy either way is going to change the economies of why you picked Alamance County. So I'd like to hear the business justification as to why you need this money. Not why you want it or can get it, but why you need it, why you need to take it from taxpayers in a struggling economy. And Commissioners, I'll address commissioners. I said my problem with these so-called incentives is they do not turn out to be an incentive. They usually end up being a housewarming gift. Companies come here with all kinds of research showing this as a good and profitable place to do business. Not if an incentive of 1% will make a bad business plan turn to good. There appears to be no direct negotiation with the county, at least that I can see, and given the secrecy leading up to these last-minute requests for money, no time given for commissioners to do a proper evaluation. Commissioners are basically expected to approve the money, which you pretty much do every time, so the public hearing process becomes just a legal necessity. Unfortunately, I think my views are falling on deaf ears. They usually do here. But I will say that on this issue, Commissioner Sutton and I seem to agree. And I admire Mr. Sutton for sticking to his principles on this issue in usually opposing it. But I would welcome his comments. And I'd just like to close in saying, not giving 1% of a $6.2 million investment will dissuade this company from building here. They've already had a facility in High Point. If you look at the strategic location within its distribution scope, this is a perfect place to locate. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well,
yes, I could just say that, you know, wealth and economic upturns and strong economies do not exist in a vacuum. And I think that there's nothing wrong with the governments, governmental agencies, states, localities, municipalities, in joining in what I will call a partnership to make communities stronger, a partnership to make the employees that work in a community stronger, give them the wherewithal to own property, send their children to good schools, have a way of life that we all want to be proud of. So I don't think there's any stigma, or there should be any stigma, to any kind of grant incentive program that might be available to private industry to come into a community and offer development and free enterprise and growth for a community to grow. It's quite right. The gentleman is right. We don't have to come to Alamance County, do we?
Okay.
However, we do have to sell pizza supplies, and we can sell those pizza supplies in any other community that we feel might be appropriate. This is not the first time we've explored Mebane and Alamance County for a location. We've done it before. And we did it several years ago during a very significant economic downturn. So we're not a stranger to making investment. We're here again to explore that opportunity again. And as the gentleman said, we are a successful company, but I don't think that's a crime. I think that is something to be proud of. And I can tell you now that the 250 people we have employed in New Jersey and the 58 people that we have employed in North Carolina and the 23 people we choose and hope to bring on and expand in our business in Alamance County and Mebane are very proud to work for Ferraro. And quite frankly, I'm very proud of every one of them.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And I just want to comment, too, that with the $6,225,000 investment, the tax base on that is going to give that back to us.
It's an investment.
It's an investment for us as well. And the tax base that they're going to provide for us will certainly be an enhancement to our tax base here. So I thank
Plus
you for that.
The county needs the jobs.
We do. Yeah.
Well, we're glad you're here.
Yes,
yeah.
Sir.
We're glad you're coming to Alamance County.
Okay. Any other comments from anybody?
Well, I would like to say that I met the gentleman outside tonight. I shook his hand and welcomed him to Alamance County. And I told him I was glad I was having a chance to meet him personally rather than just hear my vote tonight and assume everything about me from that one vote. And I explained to him my positions on cash mm-hmm. incentives and that I had consistently voted against them for the last 5 or 6 years, and there's nothing personal at all. And I wish him a lot of luck and hope they enjoy our county and what we have to offer, and we have a lot to offer. So welcome.
Thank you.
Tim. If there's
I'll make a motion that we move forward with this.
Okay.
Close the public hearing.
Yeah, I got to close the public hearing. Okay. Yeah, that's what I was fixing to do. At this time, I will close the public hearing, and then we can, I think that's all we have to do. We have to, I need to do this agreement with the Ferraro Foods. So at this time, I'll make a motion. Yep.
I'll make a motion. We close the hearing.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor to accept this agreement?
Aye.
Say aye. Opposed?
That's just for closing the public hearing?
Closing. That's for
the agreement.
Okay, I thought.
I don't have to have, I can close the public hearing.
Okay.
That's for the incentives, the cash incentives, I don't know.
Okay, that's for the cash incentives.
Okay, motion holds for that, too.
Okay, got a motion for that?
Second.
Second for that, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
No.
No, okay, there we got that one out of the way. Okay, thank you, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, now I will open a public hearing for ROAP, Mr. Martin.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. You should have in your packet a memorandum from me for the Rural Operating Assistance Program grant. The county is scheduled to be awarded $286,712 in rural operating assistance funding for fiscal year 2011-2012. And the breakdown on the allocations for this are for the EDTAP portion, or elderly and disabled transportation assistance, is $104,682. And that is split between formula funding and supplemental funding. That is the total amount for that program. The specific amounts for formula and supplemental are $71,678, and for formula and supplemental is $33,004. EMPL Work First funding is $64,681, and that is just a flat allocation for that particular part of the program. And the Rural General Public portion is $117,349. Of which $74,812 is formula funding, $42,537 is supplemental funding. You should also have attached to the memorandum, every year with the EDTAP portion, there is a sub-allocation of funding from ACTA to several different agencies in the county that utilize this funding through trips with the transit system. And then also a sub-allocation worksheet showing at the on the very last page showing how much of this will go to the Alamance County Transportation Authority and how much of it is through Department of Social Services and specifically Alamance County Community Services. Staff does recommend approval of the application and the proposed allocations. And also, I did notice that Tony Roper is here from Alamance Community Services, and Dennis Williams is here from the Alamance County Transportation Authority to answer any questions you all may have with the specifics of the program. But with that being said, I will be glad to take any questions you have for me at this time.
Does anybody on the council have any questions?
I don't have a question. I would like to make a comment. You put me on the ACTA board, and so I listened to not only what ACTA does, but how Dennis Williams manages the different funds from all the different places, and it's a challenge. But he and his staff, they do it very, very well, and this looks like a lot, and it is a lot. But I can assure you, the way that it's allocated and accounted for internally, it's spent the way it's intended.
Anybody else got any comments or questions? Anybody in the audience have any comments or questions?
Peter.
Okay. Wait, just 1 minute.
Sure.
Yeah, go ahead.
Madam Chair, just to let you know from an ACTA standpoint, the effect on us this year, reduction by the state, the portion that we receive that relates directly to Rural General Public and the Elderly and Disabled Transportation Assistance Program, those specific dollars to us during this fiscal year have been reduced $55,692 from last year. So we could be seeing some changes in service, and it's one of the things we'll be discussing in the board meeting this week. Just make you aware of that.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Children.
Yeah, hi. I'll trust commissioners on this. I just have a question ACTA, and it's about the Rural General Public Fund. It has the highest allocation here of $117,049, and I'm just interested to know how the funds, I'd be interested to know how the use of these funds is determined and who they go to.
Let me just cover with you, if you would, in answer to his question, some of the details that go into this program. I'll give you a typical week on the Elderly and Disabled Transportation Assistance Program. This happened to be the week of 9/12 to 9/17.
with the community service meal site, which is part of Mr. Roper's program. We made 120 trips. That's for elder adults with a nutrition program for meals. We did 95 trips to the Heather Road Dialysis Center, 98 trips to the Garden Road Dialysis Center. These are must-do kind of situations for folks to be able to live. That's in the Elderly and Disabled Transportation Assistance Program. In the general public side, the week of September 12th, there were 293 trips made. That was the 12th through the 16th. Just a quick breakdown on those, 41 trips to ACC Hall River, 31 to ACC Burlington, 6 trips to care facility, usually taking a member of a family, a spouse, to visit the other spouse in a care facility, 3 trips to Twin Lakes, the same thing, 36 trips for shopping, 33 trips for medical appointments, 2 trips to take Amtrak, 19 trips to Friendship Center, 2 trips to a daycare center, 2 trips to Social Security office, 118 trips taking people to work, to the library, Anderson Products, Elon University, YMCA, Orange Enterprises, TJ Maxx, White Oak, Apollo Chemical, Kaiser Ross, Sports Endeavor, ARMC, JR's, The Oaks, Goodwill, and AccuCoke. So these are a lot of these folks who are making minimum wage are utilizing this Rural General Assistance Program. Everybody who rides in this program pays $7 each way as part of their fares that underwrite this program. And the balance of that, which is about $10 per trip, is underwritten with funds from these funds, as well as some of the allocation that we get from the county each year.
Yes. Is there a qualifier? Do you, when someone gets on your vehicle, do you have to verify that they are within or below a certain income level?
We only do that with the Elderly and Disabled Transportation Assistance Program. It's a matter of filling out a form. It's a statement from them. We do verify that these are folks who are not qualified for DSS-type programs where transportation would normally be provided, so it's someone outside of that realm. They have too much earnings or too much in assets where they have to ride, you know, through a program such as this, or individuals without cars. The rural general public side, anybody here today, if you want to go to or from anywhere in Alamance County, we'll take you on the rural general public for $7 each way. There are no other qualifications on that.
But the folks that sign up, they fill out one time, so you have a lot of repeat.
Yes. Rural general public, we don't require a sign. We have to have knowledge of the trip and how to get in touch with them. That's logged in, but the elderly and disabled does require a form that we keep on file. Correct. Any other questions? Does that answer your question?
Thanks.
Okay.
Very much.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Dennis. Any more questions from anybody in the audience or commissioners?
Madam Chair, if I may, I also would like to offer to anybody in the audience tonight that we do have the Title VI participation forms here this evening if they wish to fill one of those out. It's completely voluntary that we submit to the state along with the grant application so that they can put that in with their records as well. So.
Okay. Well, if there's no other comments, I will close the public hearing at this time. And I will entertain a motion to accept this grant.
I'll make that motion.
I have a motion.
Second.
And a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed? Okay. Thank you. And I think you're still up.
One more item. You should have another memorandum in your packet this evening from me regarding the 2007 Housing Development Grant. CDBG grant. That was a $250,000 grant that the county was awarded in 2007. It was a partnership along with Habitat for Humanity for the Bend Court project in Graham. Habitat for Humanity constructed 14 houses in that project, and the county's portion of that was to do infrastructure improvements for drainage, I believe it was stormwater controls, streets, and water and sewer improvements in that neighborhood. All the houses are constructed and they are set to close. They've got qualifying families to purchase the last two homes in that project. Set to be done by the end of this month, I believe. And so staff is requesting, as part of the grant closeout process, to schedule a public hearing for October 3rd.
Okay.
And with that, I'll be glad to take any questions you have at this time.
Anybody have any questions?
No, I've been on the board of Habitat, but that's been a tremendous project. It's really worked out well, and they're also giving one of the lots back to the city of Graham. We're going to do a playground over there,
okay,
which I think will be a nice addition to.
They just finished one house that I did the ribbon cutting on this past week.
Add to that, Alamance County employees, I believe through the United Way project, the United Way fundraiser every year for the last two or three years have helped to construct those houses there. And so it's been a, I'll just say on a personal level, it's been a very personal, you know, project for me. I actually got to drive nails on that project and do a lot of other things. So it's been a very good partnership with Habitat for sure.
United Way is also at the kickoff there.
Yes.
Aren't there some additional lots, though, not affiliated with this program? It seems like I read there was a total of 20.
That's all of the lots. Once it's two more lots to be built on, left in there, and then the playground.
The whole thing's done?
Yep.
That's great.
We're going back to Burlington.
Good.
Yep.
Okay. At this time, I'll entertain a motion to set the public hearing for October the 3rd. I have a motion.
Second.
And a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, we got that set, Jason.
Thank you.
Okay. Moving right along. Have a budget amendment from the Sheriff's Department.
Good evening, Madam Chair and council members, commission members. The Sheriff's Office applied for and subsequently received a portion of a grant, the Edward Byrne Memorial Justice Assistant Grant. It's commonly referred to, a lot of times you'll hear it as a JAG grant. The amount of the grant received for our apportionment for the Sheriff's Office was $13,725. I guess what's paramount about this grant is that it requires no county funds and it's not a county match for it. It's straight out grant funds. The enclosed in your packets, I believe, is the proposed expenditures. If you have any questions.
Anybody got any questions for Mr. Holland? If not, I'll entertain a motion to accept this budget amendment.
So moved.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed. Okay.
Thank you.
Next, I have a budget amendment from the Health Department. Good evening, Mr. Bass.
Commissioners, hope everyone's doing well tonight. The first budget amendment we have for your consideration tonight is a $14,624 grant from the Division of Health Services Women's Health Branch. And these are TANF funds that are to be used in women's health for providing clinical family planning services for at-risk individuals who are not covered by Medicaid or other sources of reimbursement. And the at-risk services that we would be funding would include psychosocial counseling, our medical nutrition therapy, and wraparound services, including enhanced pregnancy follow-up, as well as our intensive care coordination for women and children. So
okay.
That's our proposal. Again, this doesn't require any match. It's a straight grant from the state.
Okay, that's the first one, so you need to take action on that one at this point. So I'll entertain a motion.
Second.
And second. I have a motion and a second. All in favor of accepting this budget amendment, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed. Okay.
And the second one is for $100,000. Well, this is a very interesting budget amendment in that these are flow-through funds. This is for a school health nursing initiative. And historically, until this session of the legislature, the ABSS had a direct relationship with the Division of Public Health for these funds. And the legislature this year decided that the money would come down to the local health departments. And then, like in our case, we have no intention of changing how we're doing business, but we've now become a responsible fiscal agent as well as reporting back to the state. So now we have to have a separate agreement with the state for the services, as well as with the school system in terms of monitoring, reporting in this grant. So all we're doing is a flow through from the state to go from to our school system. It's just funding two of the school health nurse positions.
Okay. Any questions?
It's a weird way of doing business,
it
but
is.
Whatever.
Any questions?
Yes,
If not, I'll entertain a motion that we accept this budget amendment.
I'll make a move.
Have a motion?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Bass. Okay. You're still up.
We have a unique opportunity in Alamance County. This is a project launch grant, and as you all have in your information packet, this is the linking actions to unmet needs in children's health. And we were approached from the Division of Public Health to apply for this grant. This is actually in its third year, and the state has the actual grant with the feds, and they have assigned it to a county in North Carolina. And the previous county that was had this grant, they weren't meeting the obligations and conditions of it. So the folks in the Division of Public Health were familiar with the work that's been going on at Alamance County in terms of our early childhood system of care. And they have also had heard about like our conveyor belt concept that we've been working on trying to develop services for families and children. Now, as you all know, the other grant that we have under the SAMHSA grant through the Alamance Alliance is a grant which is working on treatment, whereas this grant will be working on prevention. It's more in line with the public health model of trying to early identification of problems and getting families into services. So what we're proposing to do in this grant would be, one, we would have a program coordinator, which is required by the grant, who would oversee the entire project, and that would be similar to a gerrymander person working on the health side. And we would also have a person who would be a three-quarter time actual, the hands-on doing all the contracts and programming and the day-to-day operations. So those would be the only two positions that would come through. Again, that would be directly part of the county operations, and everything else is going to be contracted out. But in our concept, we will be working very closely with Piedmont Health Services and Charles Drew Clinic, and also working with Burlington Pediatrics to have a behavioral health specialist and a family advocate. So when these families are identified, to be able to work with them to get them to services. So if we were to receive this grant from the state, we would be the only one in North Carolina that would be doing project launch. Additionally, we would be only one of 26 in the United States that would be doing this. And as I had said earlier, you know, this is a portion of what we are looking at in terms of the conveyor belt, trying to provide services for families and children who are at risk in Alamance County. Roughly, the grant is going to be about $450,000 a year for up to a three-year period. It does not require a match, but the state has to do the match requirement because it comes down from the Fed. So that's our proposal.
Well, when they took it away from the other county, were we getting a percentage of that?
No, sir. No, sir. The other county was getting this entire grant amount. So for whatever reasons, and they certainly didn't elaborate to us on what the difficulties were, but the decision was made to look for another grantee, and they approached Alamance County about doing this.
You think the SAMHSA grant had anything?
Well, I think that was the fact of what's all the good work that's been going on certainly had an impact in what's happened in our community, and they saw this would, you know, Alamance County's done a great job of doing that, so they thought we would be a successful place of implementation. Now, we haven't gotten a grant yet, but we do, you know, feel very strongly that we've got a good opportunity here.
Was it a three-year grant where it was?
No, sir. It was a five-year grant initially. So the state has a five.
So we're getting the 3 years remaining of what was a five-year grant?
That's correct. Due to the implementation, yes, sir.
So the first 2 years, and what was the other county? You're allowed to say that.
That would be Guilford County.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So it's pulled from Guilford County after 2 years because that's like what was done.
We're not going to get the same chairman of that organization, are we?
No, sir. We will have we will have total independent decision making as to who's hired in this position. This will be Alamance County, and so we'll be the folks who will be making the decision.
Y'all will drive the bus.
Sounds like we don't need that guy.
No, sir. I don't know. Again, I don't know the details of what happened in another county. But
what happens at the end of 3 years?
Well, that's where we're going to have to be working towards sustainability, and hopefully we're going to have things like Medicaid, if the people who have reimbursable services, as well as insurance and other opportunities. So the other thing is, like, these positions that we've got here would go away at the end of the grant funding cycle. and let, you know, but the issue is we do want to sustain the program and be able to continue the program. So we'd like to put the positions in, you know, and in place to where we can have that kind of continuity. So this, again, there's no county match or any back, you know, this, again, it's a straight grant. The state has to meet the grant requirements, the match requirements. And again, the sustainability piece is going to be a challenge. But again, if there are no funds at the end of the day, then the positions certainly go away. But the scary part, again, is you don't want to be able to program in 3 years and lose that kind of momentum to services to the people.
Well, yeah, because the needs are still there.
That is correct. Yes, sir.
Is there going to be a money coming in from the federal government after those 3 years?
No, sir. The grant, we don't know. So the grant's only for a 3 year period. And again, the grant is dependent upon the availability of funds. That was made clear to us that, you know, if the state doesn't get the funds, then we're not going to get them. So it is contingent upon that. So there's no of us coming back and asking you all for support to continue it.
But it will be your department that actually does the application and the.
Yes, sir. And we will be the administrator. We will be responsible back to the Division of Public Health in terms of carrying the grant obligations out. Yes, sir.
So we need a motion on this?
Yes, ma'am.
I'll make the motion that we accept that and to end of those 3 years, that we don't extend it past 3 years. And if we do, I want the county management to come back to us and let us approve it. No, I don't want it into the budget where it's going to be forever.
No, it don't go in our
budget.
Yes,
it does. That's the way it's always happened in government. It always happens. Yeah,
the money will be accepted by the county. That's correct.
Yeah, right. Yeah. But it'll be a pass-through funds coming.
Yes, and it will be part of our budget, so you would see it going in.
That's what I'm afraid of.
But once it's passed, I understand what you're saying.
Once it goes on to the budget, the county management just seems to throw it right back in there, and we don't have I want the option to vote on it after 3 years.
Absolutely. You know, and again, we would be, you know, again, as it stands today, this is only for a period of 3 years.
Yeah.
I'd like to ask a couple of questions. Of the $1,350,000, I understand three times that annual figure that you quoted, $1,000,004,000. How much outside consulting are you going to have and pay for? Like SAMHSA, I understand $500,000 a year to Duke University. And, yeah, can't seem to get them up here to answer any questions. And the questions they wanted put to them, they wanted in advance. I didn't take care for any of that. They should be able to come up answer a few questions. How much outside consulting are you going to have to do with that money?
Well, our only outside consulting in this particular grant is we would be working with UNC Greensboro as the program evaluators. So this is a little bit different than the other grant. That was very intentional in that we could have used Duke if we wanted to, but the folks in Greensboro, UNC Greensboro, have been working on this already, so they're familiar with the evaluative piece, and that's probably part of that evaluative piece is probably how we got the opportunity that the outcomes weren't what weren't turning out to be what was needed.
And that money, how much money of the $1,000,004,000 is going to go to UNCG?
Okay, the contractual services that we have, and that includes like, as it's, okay, so it'll be 100,000 for the evaluation piece. And I was looking, and the other, we had like 169,376, but also that would include the contracted services that we have for the folks who will be in direct service delivery, like the exceptional children's program person, as well as the family advocate who will be in the practice. So that's inclusive. So it'll be right 100,000
per year. 100,000.
And that's not included in the portion that's allocated to us. That portion is taken out by DPH.
So the Division of Public Health is doing that.
Yeah, just curious. Give me an example of a child who would go through this program that they don't have recourse
without the program as far as health-related matters?
Well, right now, they're part of medical practice is trying to get behavioral health as part of primary care. And so at this point, you don't see a lot of, like, in your pediatric practices, looking at behavioral health specialists within it. So as it currently exists, what you're asking me, we're trying to establish a situation where you would have a behavioral specialist on site. So as a child is coming through and perhaps they're scoring a little less than normal on the test, that the person who is the exceptional children's person could have a consultation, a direct, if you will, a direct handoff from the physician to them to have the relationship with the family and to see, okay, are we going to, are there other referral resources that need to be made in terms of getting this child access to care? So the concept is a new one in trying to establish where your primary care physician, where's a, you know, in the case of children, a pediatric practice, would have a behavioral health specialist who would be on site. And so they, if they identify that kind of a problem, and historically there's not been a lot of physician practices that have done behavioral health. So this is a new concept, and we're trying to implement a best practice and see how it goes. So this is new ground. Yes, sir. In terms of service delivery.
And I see it goes birth to 8.
That's correct. Yes, ma'am.
Any more questions?
I'll second Bill's motion.
Okay. All right. I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed.
Thank you.
Okay.
Appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Bass. Okay. Next, we are going to Mr. Albright. I think you are up next.
We have some maps up here. I'm going to ask Bruce to step up. This is the remaining 9% of the Alamance Orange Line. That's the bill that we had presented to the legislature and they passed this year, Senate Bill 200. We're going to request a board set a public hearing for October 17th, 2011 at 7 o'clock to receive input from property owners along these this 9%, and I'll let Bruce walk you through the maps here. You should have copies of them.
The black and white's kind of hard to read. So,
yeah.
May I ask you just to please point out the geodetic line versus the.
Well, if you look on the first map, which is the entire county, it's the black line, and of course that far out it's hard to see. So we zoomed into those three different sections.
Do you have a pointer?
Right,
show me the geodetic on each sheet if you don't mind.
Everything in black, geodetic. And actually, we're not getting the whole screen.
Oh, you hit that pretty quick.
Yeah, go through that again. Sorry. This is geodetic. Black, black, black. 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 It's a little bit further down. Okay, can you make the whole thing?
Well,
it's not showing up on this screen.
Well, you see the little deviations in picture two there.
This is all black. This is the 9th Street group.
Right.
This is one of the petitioners. And this is the 9% in orange. This is a neighborhood to the south, which matches 3 over here, that was currently orange and is going to stay in orange. This is Eliza Lane, which is the very northern part of the county, which would stay in orange.
So Eliza's going to stay in orange.
Eliza would stay in orange. Where it was going to be, their backyards were going to be dissected. And if you guys remember from the public hearing, they wanted to keep those neighborhoods that already existed, you know, not split apart. And if I'm in the backyard, do I call Alamance County 911? Those kind of, again, they proposed it as a safety issue in those areas. And again, of course, you know, a big issue was Tanger Outlets wanting to keep, you know, their neighborhood and everything, same, citing the same reasons in Alamance County, which we would have lost a portion. Collington Farms is a hit and miss. I mean, it really is where they're currently taxed. They just, instead of splitting property, they would go along the property lines. And then the future phases of Collington Farms in Arlington, same difference. They've already had everything planned out. They just didn't want it to split the properties in half. Again, this is Orange County's proposal. They will be here at the public hearing to
answering your questions, but again, this is essentially the same thing you saw last December. And the law sets these dates that we have to go through this, and the public hearing, of course, setting the public hearing so that we can hear from the public on both sides. But Orange County representative will be here on the 17th to answer any more questions, and again, this is part of the legislative process. Okay. And then, of course, you know the 91% is done. So you now have an official survey in Raleigh, and you should congratulate yourselves on that, because I was looking at that number, 1849, on the plaque. Hasn't been set up until then, so.
That's great.
We're almost done with this, so.
And then this is all we're going to do.
Well, then we go to Guilford.
Show us my favorite one, the county line being moved around a cul-de-sac. Can you please show me that
one? Farms. Can you?
I see it.
Wait, I got it. Here we go. Right here, Collinson Farms.
Mm-hmm.
Is that it? Yeah.
Now, where's the geodetic in regards to that yellow line?
The geodetic would literally go down the middle of these homes, okay, like that. And the request from them was, and there's the very tip of it down there. The request from them was that they wanted to go around the properties. Okay. If you notice in purple, that's what we tax, and orange is what they tax. So all it did, all they suggested was keeping that contiguous along the property lines. And then again, this is Orange County proposal.
I always think it's funny, frankly.
Okay.
So all we're asking for is to set a public hearing for the 17th.
Okay. I'll entertain a motion for that.
I'll make a motion.
I have a motion. Second. I need it. I got a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. No opposed.
Before you sit down, let me say something here. You know, I know everybody gets tired of my position on this, but I called down to Franklin County today. Franklin County and Wake had the biggest precedent out there, as far as I'm concerned, when they set the geodetic line as the county boundary. They weren't deviated from it. They weren't moved from it. And said if a piece of property, if you had a piece of property and it was split by county line, you paid a portion for that county and a portion for the other county. Mm-hmm. House split, you paid the majority of the house where the master bedroom was. I mean, it wasn't like it was rocket science. But I called down to the planning department of Franklin County today, mm-hmm, and it was 4:45. And I couldn't believe I got somebody on the phone. And I asked them, I said, can you tell me how this debate in Wake and Franklin came about? And the planner told me, he said, well, it was over a developer that built on the county line and had the county line that went along with the street plan in the development, and that was not the county line. And said they just stuck to their guns and said, we're not going to deviate from the geodetic line, and you're going to pay no matter what. Whatever county you're in, you're going to pay, irregardless. And I said, did you have many tax agreements in the past? In other words, here I said, the debate was we had somebody that had been paying Alamance County taxes for 20-some years off of a letter that said, don't take this as proof that you live in our county. We're just going to let you pay the tax. And they lived with that for 20-some years, a quarter of a century. And then they come along and want to change it and had the majority of our board go along with their argument. And I said, did you have many of those private agreements? No, we didn't have hardly any of those. And he said that, I asked him, I said, how many pieces of property were actually changed as far as they were paying one county rate and then with the geodetic, taking the geodetic solely, that they had to switch to the, he said, none. He said, because we weren't allowing that to start with. And so, you know, there's some heavy precedents up there that we don't do silly things like go around a cul-de-sac. And yes, I do say it silly. And I think you're going to be surprised. I hadn't heard from the Rhinoceros Times did a expose here just last week, and Skip Austin said that he had done his research, and he, unless he's changed his mind, that he said he wasn't going to deviate from geodetic because he thought it opened up more problems than it would solve. Now, I don't know what the rest of the board is saying, so, but my position will never be to change anything past the geodetic.
Thank goodness they know, like Skip Austin.
Yeah, there you go.
He knows what he's doing about on this line. If you think going around a cul-de-sac makes any sense, I'll take Skip Austin's position any day of the week.
Okay, let's move along here. Next, Ms. Roberts, you have the report. We've already got the public hearing.
The board asked that by resolution had me prepare an advertisement authorizing and advertising a sealed bid for the sale of this property at 717 Park Avenue or Park Street. We did. We put the advertisement in the paper 30 days ago. We had our bid opening today. And I have received one bid from O&E Enterprises. Cashier's check was for $1,000. That was the only bid received.
Wow.
If you look at the second page of the bid letter, they'd like that entered into the record, the type of things that they do for the community, the number of individuals employed, their intentions with regard to the property. And I believe they have a PowerPoint presentation, but before they do that, I want to tell the board that I had a bit of luck. I actually found the files for this property. The LME was cleaning out their closet, getting ready to move, and uncovered a letter from Lewis Allen, who was the attorney for the mental health board that handled this transaction. I have copies I can pass out, but let me tell you what this letter says. The question came up on November 30th, 1995, somewhere towards the end of 1995, about the ownership of the property. No one could find any documents that had been recorded, and Mr. Lewis Allen went through his paperwork and explained how the county came to own this property. Back in 1988, the local mental health board could not own real property by statute. They wanted to buy this piece of property and couldn't do it because they couldn't hold title to it. So the county stepped in and took title to the property and entered into a lease agreement with the local mental health folks. The monthly rental on which was paid to the bank for the note. And it was an $850,000 note, and I believe the property was purchased for about $1 million, $1,100,000, it looks like. I don't know where the other $250,000 came from. John Paisley was the chair of the mental health board at that time, and John couldn't tell me definitively where it came from, but there was some funding somewhere from another organization, maybe a grant. Anyway, the property was purchased, and the note was assigned to Nations Bank, and the note was paid off in 7.5 years. The county simply took their lease payments from the mental health folks and paid them to the bank. So the county, as far as I can tell, didn't actually have any money in this property. The lease is a very strange thing, the way it was written. I've read the lease, and it says no rent is due on the property after it's paid off. So the lease evidently goes on as long as the property is occupied and used by Alamance Casual Mental Health and the Substance Abuse Authority and its various divisions. And I guess O&E is one of its divisions or somehow came into possession of the property. I don't know how that happened, but in any event, that's why we're not receiving any rental payment on the property. That's just a brief history of from what I've been able to put together of how this worked. Now, the bid for $1,000 for the property, the board can reject it, the board can accept it, You can put it out for rebids if you wish.
Are the bids closed now?
The bids closed at 12 today. And there was one bid submitted and opened.
I heard what you said about the pass-through payments. As far as the property as an asset, where is that real estate? Does that show up on the county's books just like other county property that we own?
It shows up on our tax records as owned by Alamance County. And on our tax records, it shows that we purchased it March 2nd, 1988.
And what value shows up on our tax records?
Our tax records have a value of $786,390 on the building and $59,793 on the parking lot, which is across the street.
So $800,000 is an asset that we have on our books.
That's correct.
If we wrote it off, which is what would happen, how does that affect the rest of our accounting? If we write off the real estate, where's that difference come out? Does it come out of fund balance? It's got to come somewhere, does it not?
Well, we're not earning any taxes on it now, and we're not earning any.
About where does it come off our?
I'm talking about
our asset.
It's an asset to the county, and obviously we don't owe anything on it, which means it shows up in our equity.
Right.
Well, which account does that show up, and how would that affect?
I'm not sure. If we have an account that shows all the property that we own, the value of it, do we, Amy?
We've got a fixed asset listing
that
shows the land and the buildings. I would have to check. It's probably on that fixed asset listing, I would think. But I can verify that.
I don't know definitely if it is. I know it's in our tax records as owned by Alamance County.
Are we going to be able to assess taxes on that piece of property in the future?
Well, once it comes into private ownership.
I would think so.
Mm-hmm. Would it be private ownership with OEI?
O&E Enterprises.
It would be
if you approve the sale.
It would be taxable.
Right. Are they a for-profit or non-for-profit?
Folks are non-profit.
Mm-hmm. So it wouldn't be.
501c3.
Mm-hmm. So it wouldn't be?
Wouldn't be.
Would not be taxable.
So it's neither here nor there as far as that issue goes. How did you get the building for mental health? Can you can you give us some history of that?
I can tell you how that happened.
Please.
When mental health reform came through several years ago, the LME, the LMEs were not allowed to provide any kind of service because the LME was providing the vocational service through Vocational Trades of Alamance. They had to divest themselves of providing the service. So they put it up for bid, providing the service. I think there were four or five agencies that submitted a bid to them to take the service over. They selected OE Enterprises. And when they did, the building came with the service provision.
And so they feel like, y'all feel like the bill has already been paid for once by your umbrella.
We didn't own it when it was paid for,
right.
But we certainly feel like that the building has been paid for by, the building was paid for by the people who work in OE Enterprises. The employees who have disabilities earn the money that paid for that in a large part.
So a theory of the parent group, supposedly. Pay for building. Okay.
Well, and that's correct. The LME had to basically divest all of the direct services they were providing, and they've done that except for the crisis center. And I guess that's part of this thing that you're going to be talking about next. But once OE, I'm not faulting OE, but I'm still curious if this building is on our fixed asset listing, and you just take it off. Doesn't that affect something?
Like our bond rating?
Well, I don't know.
Something to do with
if we have, I don't know that much about government accounting, but I do know that if it's taken off the left side, something's got to be taken off the right side. And I'd like to know what that is.
Well, you should be able to answer that with Hillcrest. What happened to Hillcrest when Hillcrest was sold to Blessed Sacrament?
Well, I cannot answer that.
See, it's the same thing. I mean, it's a... How many of y'all been out to the building?
I have.
You been in the building?
Yeah, I've been through it.
Okay, yeah, we went through it today.
We did.
Yeah, we went out there today. It's
impressive.
It's bad.
It's a solid building.
Yeah.
I don't think it's bad. I mean,
they're going to do a lot of work on it.
Yeah, I don't think it's bad.
Well, there are alternatives. I mean, we do repeat what they did when they purchased the building. Finance it for O&E for a 10-year lease. The county can borrow the money, make the renovations, and O&E can pay the county if you don't want to accept their bid or if you don't want to offer it for a rebid. So there are other things that can be done. This was all approved by the local government commission back in 1988, this financing scheme. I found it very interesting.
It wasn't a scheme, it was a facilitator.
Well, Mr. Allen was having difficulty with it, and he's a respected attorney. I know Lewis Allen, and he wrote a 5-page letter explaining it to John Moon. He had difficulty jumping through the hoops, but it was approved by the local government commission back in 1988. I mean, that is certainly another option if you want to consider, but that would involve the county putting the money up to do the renovations, which I think now, what, about $350,000,
$360,000? Well, that's immediate. We still have to address the roof repair as well as several other things. We just received a property condition report, draft report last week, and it's still in draft form, but the siding on the metal portion of the building needs to be maintained and possibly replaced. The roof on half of the building needs to be replaced within the next 5 years. All the gutters need to be replaced. All the immediate need is about $350,000, and that's for HVAC systems, which none of the existing HVACs currently work. We are leasing commercial HVACs to cool half of the building so that people can work.
So the cool air we felt today is coming from leased equipment?
Yes, yes.
What are you paying for that lease equipment?
The contractor's hoping to get the whole thing, but $750 a month for two. I think total tonnage is about 27 tons. We had to pay for the installation as well, which was another $3,000.
And they're hoping to get those returned soon.
What about your heat and heating?
Well, there is no heat at the moment.
None at all?
None at all.
In the whole complex?
In the whole complex. That's why we need to move as quickly as possible.
Was there heat last winter?
We had some heat, yes. Those units have since stopped operating.
Was mental health in the building again?
Yeah. We assumed that operation.
That's nothing more than transferring the service, the direct service, to a third party provider, and that's what they did at the old Alamance Developmental Center. Same thing, and then the third party group came over. Jim, I was thinking through this, your question when Hillcrest was sold. I do know that property was sold to Blessed Sacrament. And I'm just thinking the county, I don't remember how much, because like I said, that was before my time. But whatever we did at the school system, we purchased the land for Hillcrest, we built the land, built the building on the land, financed probably by bond. Whatever we got from the Hillcrest property, we would have written off the property off our asset, but then we would have gotten cash, some amount, for what we sold it for. When Smith was constructed, it literally was a trade with the people at Kmart.
Right, exactly. I remember that.
That's why I'm just curious. I'd like to know the accounting effects of writing off $800,000 if that comes out of a fund balance or do we have a fixed asset fund balance, a separate account? I don't know.
Apparently, come off fixed assets.
Yeah, it would come off fixed asset. I'm not sure what the value on fixed assets. I mean, if it's got a value tied to it. But
well, you said it was 800.
Tax base, 800 and, I'm sorry, $789,000.
But we don't depreciate our building or anything, right?
$786,000 and the land, the parking lot's another 60, roughly 60,000.
Yeah, the total's a little over 800.
Right.
We don't depreciate, do we, Andy?
We do depreciate.
We depreciate our bills?
Well, then I would like to know what
it shows up on our books for.
Okay.
They'd be sitting there at a zero.
Probably. Excuse me. They have a PowerPoint presentation, if the board would like to see it, about the program and the type of work they do in the community.
If you've held the asset for that long of a period of time, it's probably fully depreciated.
Well, that's what we know. The land's not fully depreciated. What did you say the land was valued at? Fine.
That's the parking lot across the street. So 70.
Not the land portion of the building.
The market value of the building and the land it sits on is $786,390. I don't have a land value here. 74,244 square feet in the building. I'm sorry, it is a land value. 63,000 of that is land value.
Not counting the parking lot.
Not counting the parking lot. 723.
Which we would not depreciate the parking lot either, right? Or at least most of it.
It's gravel lot.
Right, so it's essentially land.
Yeah, that's roughly 60,000.
So $130,000?
Mm-hmm.
16.
Well, I agree, the building's probably fully depreciated or close to it.
It was built in 1920. Part of it was. And some of it was built sometime after that. We're not exactly sure when it was built. The second half.
Well, I guess my question is this, and I've talked to Tom Steele. I'm fully supportive of what LE does and what they've done. If we're going to let the building go, then are we prepared to, in essence, write off or give $130,000 in value, assuming the building's depreciated? And I think that's what it comes down to. Mm-hmm. If I'm understanding the accounting right. In essence, it's going to come out of something, mm-hmm. and that's the equivalent of $130,000.
That's correct. Of an asset that's still there.
Well, we're writing it off, and it'll have to come out of some fund balance somewhere. Mm-hmm. And if that's what the board wants to do, fine. But I think we need to understand that's what we're doing, if that's what we're doing.
Right. And then again, if you want to keep it, and we'll have to make the repairs if we want to lease it. Because they're going to need heat. And a few weeks.
It would cost us more to repair it.
I agree. I think it'd be a mistake to keep it. I don't want the county to be responsible for any funds just to replace that roof and to repair that building, to replace the heating and cooling. I'm going to make the motion that we accept $1,000 and let them have it, and lots of luck. I mean, that's a service. I think it's a good program, and I think it's through the years it's been very good for the county.
Very good.
And for the citizens of Alamance County.
Yeah.
And it's a program that we don't have elsewhere in this county really fills a.
And I'll second that motion. I agree, and I've had experience with even through the LME. But I would like to know the accounting effect of doing that transaction. I would like to know that. Not prior to, but just as a matter of information.
We'll get that information.
We can get that. I can get that to you tomorrow.
Well, there's no rush. Just next meeting, whatever.
We'll be back Wednesday.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
I think you'd be supposed to see the
thing
first.
Okay. We're not going to let them off that easy, are we?
All right.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, I thought y'all were going to let me off easy tonight.
How dare you pay?
That's right.
Okay. Right button goes forward. Yeah, it sure does. All right. We are OE Enterprises. I am, for those who I have not met, Tom Wilson. I'm the site director for our Alamance and Caswell operations. As we've discussed, we occupy the building at 717 North Park Avenue, which is currently a county building. What we do and who we are, OE, we believe, stands for Opportunities for Everyone. We believe in giving everyone an opportunity to work to their fullest potential. And our mission is to create opportunities for personal and professional growth. We accomplish that in several ways. Well, first of all, we provide vocational placement training and support for individuals with disabilities, and we have been a fixture in the business community for over 35 years. And we have worked with businesses from the triangle to the triad. And actually, as I was looking at that slide earlier, that's a little misleading. We've actually worked from businesses from California to Ireland to Brazil. We are truly plugged into the global marketplace. Our Alamance operations actually comprise over a third of our total business. It's our largest operational center. That consists of our program services for vocational services for individuals with disabilities, our production services, our collaborative fulfillment with area businesses for their production needs, our shredding operations, our secure document destruction business, which Commissioner Boswell has seen and Commissioner Sutton saw today, which in our shredding operations, we actually do the document destruction for all 16 IRS offices in the state of North Carolina, as well as local businesses, local doctor's offices. The LME is a customer of ours. Anyone who may need to securely destroy their documents. And we have started a cleaning service to provide high quality, low cost cleaning services to individuals who are low income, nonprofits, and for profit businesses in the area. We currently in Alamance County employ 67 staff. And those 67 staff provide services to 225 individuals at any given time. We place an average of 50 people in community employment every year. And those are 50 people that we put in a job of their own in a local business. And while revenues and profitability are not our primary focus, we put $1.5 million a year in wages back into the Alamance County community. A key statistic that we're very proud of is that more than half of the people that we serve are served in the community in a job of their own and not in our facility. And the individuals we serve in our facility receive training and earn wages through the collaboration that we have with local businesses. Some benefits that we offer to our Alamance County business partners, people that would hire individuals with disabilities through us. They get an employment specialist who becomes their single point of contact throughout their relationship with us. But they get recruitment assistance and that single point of contact for follow-up. We offer pre-screened applicants, and we reduce a business's recruitment costs because in a lot of cases, people that have worked with us for a long time, instead of putting an ad in the paper, they'll just pick up the phone and call us. We also offer training and consultation services to our Alamance County business partners. Customized responses to HR needs, education about managing a diverse workforce, assistance with accessibility, planning, job coach to meet shorter long-term needs of the individual and the employer that we're supporting, and consultation on available tax credits. And all of that is free of charge to the business. And by using our applicants, they expand their labor pool, and we provide employers with qualified, well-trained applicants. This is just a list of some of the people that we currently work with in Alamance County. And as you can see, that's a pretty large list, and that's probably about a third of our local business partners. Everyone from the hospital to Chili's restaurants to Alamance Community College, the K&W cafeteria. And you can see the types of jobs that we employ people in. Everything from truck driver to body shop technician to stock clerk. We've set people up with their own small businesses, what's called micro enterprise. You name it, we've probably placed someone in that role before. Our production facility, we are an ISO 9001:2008 certified facility, organization rather, I should say. We just 2 months ago received our 3-year recertification under ISO. So this is not a new thing for us. We've been certified now a full 3 years and have been through our full recertification audit. Our customers range from medical device companies such as MedTox, Convatec, and BD Diagnostics to industrial supply companies such as Sunoco Cardboards and Armacell. Armacell is something that's really grown for us in the past year. It started, we were producing 3 variations of one size of tubing fitting. Armacell, and you've probably seen their large facility right on the side of 4085 out here, they produce extruded foam insulation. And for them, they want to produce it in 6-foot lengths and box it up and ship it to a distributor and be done with it. On the side of their box, they have instructions for the contractor on the job site for how to put these fittings together. You can imagine how excited contractors are about paying their highly paid tradesmen to cut and glue fittings together on site. Armacell realized the need a few years ago to start producing fittings because their competitors are starting to do so. And they came to us about producing these fittings for them. We started with 3 variations, one size of tubing. We're now up to between 800 and 900 different variations that we produce for them. And they have quickly become one of our largest customers, if not our largest customer. For 5 years, we've provided a work crew within LabCorp's IT warehouse here in Burlington. This being LabCorp's corporate home, all of their IT equipment and all of their remote sites leaves from and comes into a centralized warehouse here in Burlington. When it comes into the warehouse, it's in disrepair and it's probably got some sensitive data on it. It's got a lot of components that need to be pulled and recycled because they can't go in the landfill. It's a problem. LabCorp came to us with this problem. We offered a solution. We have a crew that works over there 40 hours a week, started small with 4 consumers and 1 staff. We've more than doubled that in the 5 years we've been working with them. It's now up to 10 consumers and 2 staff. And we decommissioned all of their obsolete equipment. In the last year to 2 years, we've started working with their IT equipment on the front end. No longer do we just take the equipment that's being taken out of service, but all of their new equipment that comes to them from Staples Technology comes to us first. We asset tag it and log it into LabCorp's asset management system, and then it leaves from us and goes to their warehouse to go out to their remote sites. So we're involved at the front and back end of that operation. Sunoco has also become another one of our large contracts. 2 years ago, we started making a lightweight, cost-effective, and recyclable cardboard pallet for Sunoco. Sunoco is a cardboard company. They got tired of handling big, heavy wooden pallets that splinter. When they're torn up and broken up, there's not a whole lot you can do with them. They're not worth much anymore. They're kind of a hazard, and they're a bit of a pain. So they designed their own cardboard pallet for their own use. And it's become so popular that they've started selling it as one of their items. It is what they call their eco pallet, and this is their marketing piece on it. It's economical, ecological, eco-perfect. 75% lighter than wooden pallets. It saves time and money, significant freight weight savings. It's export approved. It reduces back and hand injuries. And they offer in standard and custom sizes. And it is 100% recyclable. So we've now gotten involved with Sunoco on the back end of this process. Whenever their cardboard products are no longer usable, they now come to us for either refurbishment, which some things we can refurbish, send back to them, and they can reuse. Sunoco is very green in that they really believe in reusing their products until they are no longer usable. And if it cannot be refurbished, then we compress, recycle, and destroy, and send the product off to Georgia-Pacific to be recycled. As I referred to earlier, we started Carolina Shredding Authority a little over 2 years ago, providing, again, secure document destruction to all 16 IRS offices, medical facilities, nonprofits across North Carolina. As we continue to grow that business, that is going to provide us with the ability to provide more jobs, both for individuals with disabilities and individuals without. It will be truly a job creation machine for us. Carolina Cleaning Associates is another offshoot that we've started in the last year. And this started as a way to provide assistance for senior citizens and those with low income who may not have the ability to maintain their home, but also can't afford the Molly Maid or the other commercial cleaning service to come in. We are extremely cost competitive with those companies, and we provide a high quality service. We've also started working with several nonprofits in the area and local businesses. Making this move as a board of commissioners and transferring this building to OE Enterprises will further cement our presence in the community and strengthen the community in the process. Our investment into the property for renovation will create an even stronger investment by OE into the community. And we expect that the refurbishment of that building will lead to a positive impact on the property values surrounding it. So that, you know, maybe that will lead to a brightening of that sector of the city and a refurbishment, revitalization of that sector of the city. Moving forward, I move forward too fast. We look forward to becoming an even larger part of our Alamance County as we go forward. And as part of my presentation, I've actually asked a couple of families that we support to come and say some words. I haven't prepped either one of them. I don't know what they're going to say about me. First, Ms. Evans, would you like to? I promised you I'd stand up here when you talk.
Okay. Good evening. I'm Ann Evans, and these are my sons, John and Matthew. Mm-hmm. And John and Matt mm-hmm. are employed at K&W Cafeteria as busboys on the lunch shift. They've been working at K&W since May of 2005. They love their jobs, and they do a very good job. They have been successful at K&W because they receive job coach services from OE. The job coach taught them their routine and now remains with them to ensure their safety and to learn any new skills that they might need. The OE job coach and John and Nat make a great team, right? Alamance County has always been a leader in providing services for people with disabilities. And OE provides a much needed service to help people have a more meaningful and productive life. And we thank you tonight for your support.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ian.
This is Mr. Anthony Cazatori.
Good evening. I'm sorry my son could not be here. My wife's got a migraine headache, so she's got to be home with Matt. Matt is my 29-year-old Down syndrome son. We are pleased to be a new resident, basically, of Alamance County. We moved here a year and a half ago. And I have been able to work with four different ARCs throughout different states. And in addition to what OE does, I can't thank the towns and the counties for what they do for us. Just for a perfect example, I've been unemployed, unfortunately, on and off for the last 2.5 years. And we matched, just finally got approved into the program about 3 months ago. And during that time, that included my wife to go ahead and get a part-time job. And because in the past, she would have to stay home, you know, and that obviously doesn't work too well. So she's been able to get a job. And so that's an added advantage you might not realize, but it does work out. Matt right now is training on a new program that they're going to be protein test strips. And they give him a little block, and he puts 34 little pieces on it. When it's done, he puts it in a bag. Sounds pretty easy for all of us, but he's very proud of what he does. As a matter of fact, I had a chance to go there last week to see what he does. And as a parent, it makes you feel good. It really does. So anything you can do to help support OE, please, please, please do that. It means a lot to not only my son and these people here, but the families, and I'm sure the community. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's all I have.
Okay. Thank you so much. Yes,
Madam Chair, I'd ask that your resolution include the authority for the county attorney to prepare the deed, complete the conveyance working with Mr. Steele, attorney Tom Steele, and authorize the chair to execute any and all documents.
We have a motion. Yeah, a motion. And second. All in favor say aye.
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 All right.
Can I say something? I got to say this. I've known the voice for how many years did you agree to?
About 20.
20-some years, when they were over at Andrews Elementary School. I see them here tonight, and I see them at K&W. I think it proves that we're family, and we'll always be family. And we take care of our own. That's Kenny.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. All right, with that done, Ms. Carbright, you're up again. With the LME Interlocal Grant Orders.
Tonight is my night.
Yes, it is.
We're approaching the deadline for the winding down of the LME, and I've been trying to get some things resolved with regard to getting some merger documents in and making sure that everything's tied up tightly, and haven't been too successful in doing that. So. What I have before you tonight is an interlocal agreement and a project order. Now, the reason for this is we have retirees that work for the LME that the county currently pays medical insurance premiums for, $25,000 a month for those retirees. And they're going to need case management services. And the employees that are not going to be retained are going to need COBRA notification. So the manager and I sat down and discussed this, and I prepared this interlocal agreement that will ensure that these things happen. Not exactly sure how much money we're going to get from the LME, because we haven't seen any final documents. We are, based on the last report that I got, we're expecting about $3.7 million to fund the project ordinance. And hopefully that will pay the insurance premiums for 8, maybe 10 years. Of course, I don't know what Obamacare will do to insurance, but you know, we'll have to cross that bridge when we come to it. But at least this sets up a project ordinance where the county can take its appropriation for mental health funding and fund the project ordinance to ensure that the retirees of the LME will have their medical insurance and case management of their claims. And the COBRA provision, it lasts 18 months. We've tried to get all the files from the LME. We have not quite been completely successful in that regard, but we're going to continue working on it because September 30th is the witching hour, where it ceases to be. So I think I prepared a resolution.
What qualifications do they have to retire for the LME? 20 years, 10?
I think it's 20 because I know one girl just retired.
I don't.
She retired after 15.
Sure. Is the county responsible to pay that cost?
The county has been paying for the insurance for the retirees for some period of time. I don't know why.
Sherry,
it's a separate corporation.
Enlighten us on that.
I'm not exactly sure about the arrangement for health insurance. When they retire from the LME, it's really they are meeting the requirements for the local government employees' retirement system. So they're really not retiring from the LME, they're retiring from the local government retirement system. The county has had an agreement with the LME that they joined our health insurance plan. Now what has happened is each month they reimburse us the premiums for their current employees and their retirees. Mm-hmm. Our concern is that after the LME goes away, who's going to be paying that? And that's what we're trying to do, is find some funding so that we, if we continue that health insurance, that the county's not bearing that cost. So that's really what this ordinance is.
That's what I'm concerned about. I don't think the county should be bearing that cost.
Right. And that's why the resolution I'm proposing tonight is a conditional resolution. It's conditioned upon Caswell agreeing and the LME agreeing and PBH agreeing. Now, all of these things may or may not happen, but what the manager did not want to happen is to have these folks out there suddenly receive a letter that they have no more medical insurance. And so we take the budgetary surplus, which we believe will be about $3.7 million, of course we don't know for sure, but that money is supposed to come back to Alamance and Caswell. Alamance gets 80%, Caswell gets 20%. And we were going to fund this
out of that
project
excess
ordinance with that $3.7 million and continue paying the monthly premiums for that insurance for those retirees, and case management fees to the county of $23 a month per participant for managing their case files.
$2301.
Yeah. Right, and then COBRA services we think will be a flat monthly fee of $3,000 for 18 months. Now, at the end of the day, if there is less than $3.7 million, or if there's nothing left in the budget surplus, we would take our appropriation for mental health, which I think is $1.3 million now, and we'd take a portion of that and fund this project ordinance, make sure these people aren't left out in the cold, because the LME is no longer a corporation. So you're right, we don't have to do this. But it's something the manager felt was important enough to do.
Any more questions? Do I hear a motion that we accept this agreement?
I'll make a motion.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed?
No.
One opposed.
One opposed. I'm not going to vote for it.
Okay.
Does that include setting up a project ordinance as well in that resolution?
Yeah, that's the same resolution.
Okay.
It's all one paper here. Yeah.
I think you had it all combined, didn't you?
I have a resolution to approve the interlocal agreement and an ordinance to approve the ordinance to establish the.
Okay, let's do that one too separately, since we have two here. An ordinance to establish the Alamance Caswell Retiree Medical Claims and Insurance Project Budget Ordinance. So, do I hear a motion on that?
Yeah, I'll make that motion.
Second.
I have a motion on that.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye. Mm-hmm. Let me say that I made a vow that I would do everything to help the taxpayers of Alamance County, and I don't think this is helping the Alamance County taxpayers. I'm going to vote no.
Okay. One opposed. Okay. Thank you. Next is county manager reports.
Just one item to remind the board of the meeting with the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners and the local legislative delegation. That meeting will be on September 28th. It will not be in here in the meeting room, but actually go to the multipurpose room over the Sheriff's Department. You can enter from the side of the building and go in there. It does start at 8:15 and should conclude around 12:30.
Mm-hmm. That's all you have on that. Any commissioners comments, ma'am? Do I hear a motion to accept the consent agenda?
So moved.
On the motion?
Second.
On favor say aye.
Aye.
Commissioner comments? No commissioner comments?
I just want to take one moment to thank everybody for the support during my mom's death last week. It's really been comforting to know how much the employees and everybody here is supported me in their thoughts and prayers, and I just want to thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Any announcements?
I've got just one thing just put on the calendar for October 21st. We'll have a grand opening of the Piedmont Food and Ag Processing Plant. As far as I know that, we haven't changed it. So October 21st. I know it's a little out, and I'll maybe remind everybody.
Have they started, are they in operation yet?
They have started doing some processing. They got their inspections off. So, yes, it's nice joint venture we had done there. Everybody maybe can get down there for that.
Okay. If there's nothing else, we are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.